of Moses.
Well, good morning. Welcome to Cross Community Church. We are continuing our new series. It's called Jesus Is. And in this series, we are working through the characters and the context of the Old Testament to teach you more of who Jesus is. And so if you were with us last week, you know that we talked about Abraham, Father Abraham, that we you know, if you grew up in church, you sang the song, you know who he is. And we saw that while God did extraordinary things in Abraham's life, that Jesus was even greater. Jesus had a greater calling. He instituted a greater covenant, and he offered a greater sacrifice than Abraham offered. Now, we're going to fast forward a few hundred years from the life of Abraham today, and we are going to be looking at Moses. And Moses, a profound figure in the Old Testament. You're going to read a lot about him in the New Testament. God used him in miraculous and powerful ways. Now, as I attempt to walk through the life of Moses today, I'm going to need a little grace because Moses' life spans four books of the Old Testament. Exodus chapter 2 to the final chapter of Deuteronomy, you get Moses' life described, and you see his writings and the law and all that God did for him. And so I'm going to do my best to hit the high points. We're not going to cover everything. If I miss your favorite high point of Moses' life, just come chat with me about it afterward, and we can talk through all the remarkable things that God did through Moses. Now, to begin with, in Moses' life, we should probably start at the beginning. And Moses had a difficult beginning to his life. He was born amidst some very difficult circumstances. If you know kind of the story of what happened, the nation of Israel had found themselves in slavery in the nation of Egypt. And the new Pharaoh was more harsh than the ones who had come before him. And so he's requiring more from the Israelite people. He's making them work even harder. He was oppressing them more than the Pharaohs that had come before. And they began to cry out to God. Now, this new Pharaoh was a little bit intimidated because the Israelite people, they had grown and they had multiplied. And when you got lots of numbers, you got power. And so this new Pharaoh becomes concerned. And so he issues a decree that every male child born to the Hebrews should be thrown into the Nile and killed. So Moses is born into this time, into this era of their slavery there. And as any good mother would do, I mean, Moses' mother doesn't want to see her child die. And so she takes and she hides Moses for just as long as she possibly can. She kept his birth a secret. And for about 3 months, she kept him at home. And when she couldn't hide him anymore, she found a technicality there. Rather than just throwing him into the Nile, she actually had a basket fashioned of reeds. And she coated it in tar. And she placed the boy there. And she was very strategic in that she placed Moses among the reeds of the Nile at just the place where the daughter of Pharaoh happened to go down to bathe. And she left her daughter there to watch to see what would happen. And sure enough, the daughter of Pharaoh comes down to bathe in the Nile. They discover the child there, and she decides she's going to adopt him and raise him as her own. Now, she went ahead, and you know, of course, the sister of Moses is like, hey, I know a lady that can nurse him for you until he's weaned. She was like, great. So again, Moses, who was born into a time where he was supposed to be killed, now gets to be raised in the house of Pharaoh. It was a classic reeds to riches kind of story. Yeah, y'all, I worked really hard on that. I was hoping for more laughter. But anyway, he gets to be raised in the house of Pharaoh, and he's educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians. He has a profound upbringing, and as Moses grows a little bit older, he becomes a young man unto himself. One day he goes out knowing he's a Hebrew, and he sees one of the Egyptian taskmasters beating one of his fellow Hebrews, and he becomes enraged, and he steps in. You know, words were said, fists were thrown, and Moses ends up killing the Egyptian taskmaster and hit him there in the sand. And when it was discovered what Moses had done, he knew that he couldn't stay in Egypt any longer. And so he fled to a place called Midian, where for the next 40 years, he lived a life of relative obscurity. Reeds to riches, and now here he is. He's just a shepherd in Midian, tending his father-in-law's sheep. So the first thing I want to point out, He was born amidst difficult circumstances that God was going to use profoundly in his life. That's phase one. The next thing that I want you to see about Moses was that he was sent by God to free his people from their bondage and slavery in Egypt. 40 years after Moses left Egypt, he is tending his father-in-law's sheep. And as he's doing so, by the way, being a shepherd must be extraordinarily boring. You know, you just watch sheep all day and it, you know, can't get all that exciting. And so one day as Moses is doing this, he sees a burning bush. And you're like, you know, I'll play with fire. Something's going on. And so he goes to this bush, but it's no ordinary burning bush. The bush is on fire, but it's not being consumed. And an angel of the Lord speaks to Moses from the bush. And here's what he says in Exodus chapter 3, beginning in verse 7. The angel of the Lord speaks to Moses and he says, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt. Aren't you glad that our God is a God who sees the affliction of his people? I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and I've heard their cries. Aren't you glad that God hears the cries of his people? Because of their taskmasters, I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. And now behold, the cry of the people of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppress them. And then there's the turn. Come, I will send you, Moses. I will send you to Pharaoh that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moses did what probably any one of us would do if God came to us in a burning bush and told us that he was going to send us Pharaoh to lead his people out of their slavery. He starts looking through his life and his capabilities, and he begins to list off all of the ways that he is inadequate to do what God has called him to do. It's like, God, I don't know if you know this, but I'm not a real good speaker. You know, Aaron, my brother, and he just rattles off his tongue. He's really good. God, maybe you should choose someone else. Now, God wants to let Moses know that he's not going in on his own. And he's not going to go to Pharaoh and have to figure out a way to deliver his people. Instead, God's going to empower Moses for everything that he wants him to do. So he gives him a couple of signs. The first is Moses can take his staff and throw it on the ground and it'll become a snake. And then he can pick it up again and it'll become a staff. The second is that he can place his hand inside of his cloak, and when he pulls it out, it will be white and leprous. When he puts it back in, brings it back out, it will be restored once again. Fairly powerful things. I mean, if I were able to throw a stick down and became a snake, I mean, I'd get some viewers on YouTube. Something. It would be a profound thing. These are miraculous things God wants to know. Moses wants to know, I'm with you. This isn't about you. This is about me. And so Moses, he goes to Pharaoh with his brother Aaron, and he says, the God, the great I am has sent me to you. And he told me that you need to let God's people go. And of course, Pharaoh, knowing that the Israelite people, the Hebrews, they're his labor force. I mean, slave labor, were performing a lot of tasks throughout Egypt and accomplishing many of the things that Pharaoh wanted accomplished. And so he says, no, I'm not going to let the people go. And so God, through a series of plagues, one after another, works to convince Pharaoh of God's power and his sovereignty, and that he needs to ultimately submit himself to God. So there was a plague of blood, water turned into blood. There's a plague of frogs, a plague of gnats, a plague of flies. Then all the livestock died. There was a plague of boils. Then there was hail. And then there were locusts. And then there was darkness. And still Pharaoh would not let God's people go. So Moses, who probably felt like a profound failure at this point, 100% failure rate at going to Pharaoh at this point. He's been there 9 times already. Pharaoh has not relented. He hasn't let the people of God go. God says, I want you to go back again and tell him that there's a final plague. It's a plague in which the firstborn of every house in Egypt is going to die. And God gives Moses some special instructions for his people. He said, I want you to take a pure, spotless lamb, and at twilight, I want you to slaughter that lamb, and I want you to spread its blood on the doorposts of your house, because an angel of the Lord is coming to visit Egypt. The firstborn of every household will be killed, except those who have blood on the doorpost. And so the people of God, they did as they were told. They spread the blood on their doorposts, and they consumed the flesh of the lamb. And they had their belts fastened around their waist and sandals on their feet. They were ready to go because God had promised to deliver his people. And sure enough, the angel of God came. And the firstborn of every household in Egypt was slain. And you could imagine if something like that happened in our society, what the cry of the people would be. House after house and neighborhood after neighborhood all across Egypt, their firstborn is dead. He even visited Pharaoh's house. And the cry of the people was so great that in the middle of the night, Pharaoh calls Moses and says, okay, take your people and leave. And so Moses, probably a little bit shocked that Pharaoh has finally relented. He leads the people out of Egypt, only to a short while later realize that Pharaoh has changed his mind. He's got together his armies and gathered his chariots, and they're now pursuing the people of God as they approach the Red Sea. On one side, we have the sea, and on the other, it's the armies of Pharaoh. But God wasn't done delivering his people. So he tells Moses, stretch out your staff over the sea, and the waters are going to divide, and tell your people to march across on dry ground. And they did. Y'all, this wasn't like muddy. You know, this wasn't knee-deep working their way through. The waters weren't just parted. They walked across the sea on dry land. Profound. Can you imagine that? Watching the waters be parted, walking across on dry ground. I mean, if you didn't know God was with you before, like surely you know God's with you as you walk across the sea. And then just as they get to the other side, the armies of Pharaoh, they cross into the, or they come into the sea because they're going to follow him. And God brings the sea back over the armies of Pharaoh and devours them. Man, what a moment. Then as the people of God, as they were out there in the wilderness, wondering how are we going to eat? How are we going to feed all these people and all this? How are we going to make this happen? God provided for them manna on the ground, a little wafer-like substance, manna on the ground for them to eat. And when they got tired of bread, God gave them quail. He provided water from the rock for them to drink. Man, what a profound thing that God did when Moses sent God to Pharaoh to deliver his people out of their captivity in Egypt. This is a big, big moment in the history of Israel. So, Moses, born under difficult circumstances, sent by God to deliver his people from slavery in Egypt. But then there's one more big movement in the life of Moses. As they were wandering there in the wilderness, they came to Mount Sinai, and God himself calls Moses to come up on the mountain, and God comes down to meet with Moses on top of Mount Sinai. The scriptures tell us that Moses spent 40 days there meeting with God. And there on that mountaintop, God gave Moses the old covenant, the law. If you've read much law, you got a lot of Leviticus and Deuteronomy. He gave him the old covenant, the law by which the people of Israel were to live. He said, I'm going to be your God and you're going to be my people. Live like this among the nations. And where you break the law, here's the sacrificial system where you can offer the sacrifices for the sins that you've made. It's a yearly sacrifice. And if that wasn't enough, God gave Moses instructions for building a tabernacle or a tent, a dwelling where God's presence would be. And the people, once a year, the high priest could come in and meet with God on behalf of the people. It must have been an extraordinary moment to receive the law and the sacrifices and instructions for the tabernacle and to meet with God there. But no sooner had Moses begun his journey down the mountain when he realizes that the very people whom God had led out of slavery in Egypt, they'd seen the plagues. The very people who had walked through the Red Sea on dry land, the people who had been fed every morning with manna on the ground, who had drank water from the rock, who had seen God in the cloud and leading them by a pillar of fire by night. During that 40-day period, they had rebelled against God. They had convinced Aaron, the brother of Moses, to fashion them a golden calf so that they could bow down and worship it. And God is rightfully angry. look at what he'd done for them. Look at his deliverance. And the people of God had turned away from him and rebelled against him. And God's anger was kindled against them. Psalm 106, verses 21 through 23 says about the people, it says, they forgot God, their Savior, who had done great things in Egypt, wondrous works in the land of Ham, and awesome deeds by the Red Sea. Therefore, he said he would destroy them. This is what the people deserved. And God had done so much to deliver them, and now they're turning away from him. After such a short time, their hearts had turned away from God. But Psalm 106 continues. It says, therefore, he said he would destroy them, had not Moses, his chosen one, stood in the breach before him to turn away his wrath from destroying them. Moses interceded to God on behalf of the people and reminded God of his goodness and of his mercy. And he pled with God not to destroy the people. And God, who is merciful and gracious and slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, he turned his anger away from them. He did not destroy all of the people as their actions had deserved. So Moses, I mean, this is pretty profound. He goes on to lead the people there in the wilderness. He doesn't actually cross the Jordan River and lead the people into the promised land. But what an extraordinary life to be born under such difficult circumstances, be called by God to lead his people out of their slavery in Egypt, and then to be the one who met with God on the mountain to receive the old covenant, the law, the sacrifices, and instructions for building the tabernacle. What an extraordinary life. Moses' life was so extraordinary that the Jews during the time of Jesus and the writing of the New Testament, they had a tendency to be like, maybe we should worship Moses. Man, look at how profoundly God used him. I mean, he was the guy that God parted the sea for. Maybe we should worship Moses. And so if you read Hebrews, they're like, no, Jesus is greater than Moses. Like, don't worship Moses. Jesus is greater. And we're going to see that in a minute. But I want you to see some of the similarities between Moses and Jesus. Now, I could spend the rest of our time together today talking about these similarities, so I just want to point out a few for you, but I want you to know these similarities are intentional, not accidental. As a matter of fact, in the life of Moses, Moses actually prophesied to the nation of Israel, Deuteronomy 18:15, and he said, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me. One is going to come after me who's a lot like me. He's going to raise him up from among you, from your brothers, and it is to him that you shall listen." And so the nation of Israel, reading this prophecy, they were looking for someone who would come who was like Moses. And that was the one that they should listen to. And so let me lay out some of the similarities between Jesus and Moses. Okay, first, both Moses and Jesus were born during times when God's people were oppressed. The nation of Israel was enslaved under Pharaoh in Egypt. And then when Jesus was born, the nation of Israel, once again, they're living in a land that is not their own, and they're being ruled by the Romans. They didn't have their own land. They didn't live according to their own laws or customs, but instead, their lives are dominated and controlled by the Romans. Okay? Number two, both Moses and Jesus had to be hidden as babies because the rulers of the time wanted them dead. I already read for you in Exodus chapter 1, verse 22, where Pharaoh, fearing that the people had grown too numerous and powerful, he decreed that every Hebrew child should be cast into the Nile. But with Jesus, in Matthew chapter 2, verse 16, it was King Herod who ordered that every male child 2 years old and under in the vicinity of Bethlehem be put to death. So both born under difficult circumstances, both were supposed to be put to death by their rulers, or they attempted to do so. And then both Moses and Jesus were shepherds. Moses shepherded his father-in-law's sheep, and so Jesus shepherded his father's sheep, people who acted like sheep anyway. Okay. The fourth thing is that both had significant inaugural moments that kind of launched their public ministries. For Moses, it was at the burning bush where God told Moses who he was, that he was the great I am and sent him to deliver the nation of Israel out of slavery in Egypt. And for Jesus, it was his baptism by John the Baptist. For when he was baptized, the Spirit of God descended upon him like a dove, and a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, whom I love, whom I'm well pleased." This was the inaugural moment where Jesus began his very public ministry. Both Moses and Jesus were used to deliver God's people. Moses delivered people from slavery in Egypt, the nation of Israel from slavery in Egypt in a particular place in a particular time. But God sent Jesus to deliver not just a specific people in a specific place in a specific time, but God sent Jesus to deliver the world from our slavery to sin and death. And he didn't just deliver us to a promised land in a particular region, but he gave to us the abundant life, citizenship, and a new kingdom. And the final thing here is that both Moses and Jesus performed significant signs centering around food and water. For Moses, it was stretching out his staff and parting the Red Sea so that people could walk across on dry land. And Jesus was like, "I can do better." When his disciples had gone ahead of him into the boat onto the Sea of Galilee, Jesus calmed the storm and went to them walking on the water. Both performed significant signs and miracles around food and water. In Exodus chapter 16, Moses assures the people that God is going to provide. And indeed, there was manna on the ground that they could eat. There were quail provided for them to eat. There was water from the rock. And in each of the Gospels is recorded the miracle of Jesus feeding the 5,000 from 5 loaves and 2 fish. Both the Israelites in the desert and the crowds of thousands on that day, they ate until they were full as God provided for them. But don't miss this. John chapter 6, verse 14 tells us that Jesus feeding the 5,000 from the 5 loaves and 2 fish was so significant to the Israelite people, the Jewish people. And John 6, 14 tells us that when the people saw the sign that Jesus had done, the feeding of the 5,000, they said, "This is indeed the prophet who was to come." When they saw Jesus feeding the people in the wilderness, just like Moses had done, they were like, "Oh, this is the one who was to come. This is the prophet that we're supposed to listen to. This is the one who's like Moses." So a lot of similarities between Jesus and Moses. But we should be very careful not to think them equals. Jesus is greater than Moses in every single way. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 3 says, "For Jesus has been counted worthy of more glory than Moses, as much more glory as the builder of the house has more honor than the house itself." And the writer here is like, hey, consider that as wonderful and magnificent as a creation can become, it never surpasses its creator. While we might glory at the beauty of a house that's been built or the magnificence, the one who created it is always greater than that which is created. Moses was a created being, created by God to fulfill God's purposes. Moses was created to point people to God, him who was greater than Moses. Moses is not the one we should worship. Moses is not the one that we should glory or honor. Instead, Moses pointed to the one in whom we should glory and worship and honor. Moses was wonderfully created, but Jesus was the creator. Now, Moses was really just like you and me. We have a tendency to want to make him something other than us. But Moses was an ordinary man. In and of himself, he didn't possess any particular powers or ability or brilliance. As a matter of fact, he wasn't even a very good speaker. But he was created by God to point to Christ. You might think of it like this. Moses was the foreshadowing, and Jesus was the fulfillment. Moses' life and all that he did foreshadowed what God would ultimately do through his son, Jesus Christ. Jesus is greater than Moses in every way. Moses went down to Egypt to deliver his people, God's people, from their bondage and slavery under Pharaoh and to lead them to the promised land. But Jesus stepped down out of heaven to deliver the world from sin and death. Jesus is greater. During the Passover, Moses gave the people instructions to sacrifice a lamb and to spread its blood on the doorpost that the angel of death might pass over their home, that they wouldn't face death as all of the other households of Egypt did. Jesus became our Passover lamb and shed his blood that we wouldn't have to face the death that we ultimately deserve. Jesus is greater. Moses gave us the law and the accompanying sacrifices. Jesus fulfilled the law and became our sacrifice. Jesus is greater. Moses spoke the words of the prophecy. Jesus fulfilled the words of the prophecy. Moses built a tabernacle, a tent in which God's presence would dwell, where the people once a year could meet with God. But Jesus took on flesh. And he made his dwelling among people. Jesus is greater in every single way. In church, we will not understand the Bible rightly until we understand that the Bible is one big story of God working his plan of redemption from Genesis all the way to Revelation. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. You see, when you look at the life of Moses, you need to understand that Moses is not the hero. Moses murdered a guy, right? We don't want you to imitate that. We shouldn't look to him and be like, oh, Moses is a moral example. Be more like Moses. What you should see in the life of Moses is that God can take a man who once murdered someone and use him to deliver his people. God can take an ordinary man like Moses and use him in profound ways. When we look to the hero of the story, Moses was pointing to him the entire time. The hero of the story of the life of Moses is God himself. It's not the story of Moses. It's the story of God and his redemptive work on behalf of his people. And I talk to people often, especially unbelievers, who look at the Old Testament and they're like, man, why is the God of the Old Testament so harsh? Man, it seems like he was wrathful and vengeful and distant from his people. But when you see the God of the Old Testament is the same God of the New Testament, and that he was working his plan of redemption the whole time, that every person and every story in the Old Testament was really just the foreshadowing of what Jesus would ultimately fulfill. Like, they were all pointing to him who was going to come and do the final and finished work of redemption on our behalf. They were pointing toward Jesus. If you've ever seen the movie The Sixth Sense, it's one of those movies where you watch the entire time, and it's been out a long time, sorry if it's a spoiler for you, but you watch the movie the entire time, and you never realize that Bruce Willis is dead until you get to the end. And when you hit that realization at the end of the movie, everything else in the movie begins to make sense. And the same is true for the scriptures. And you read the Bible, and you're like, man, what is God doing here? You see his work in the Old Testament and among his people, and you're like, man, what's happening? Why did God respond the way that he responded? Why did he do the things that he did? Until you get to the end, and you realize that every one of those things, every character, every circumstance of the Old Testament was pointing toward Jesus. They were the foreshadowing. Jesus is a fulfillment. So our hope isn't in Abraham, and our hope isn't in Moses. Our hope is in Jesus Christ. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 through 10 tells a story that we all need to know. We often, I don't know if this happens to you, but it's happened to me quite a lot in my life. I read the Old Testament and I think, those people were so dumb, you know? Like, why? How come they couldn't get it right? They walked across the Red Sea on dry ground, and, you know, not long after, they're worshiping a golden calf. What are they doing? Like, did God not work profoundly in their lives? Like, this is crazy. But as we read the Old Testament, we shouldn't look at it and scoff and think, man, those people were so sinful and so rebellious. God was so patient, you know? When we read the Old Testament and we read the law and we see their failures, we should also see ours, that we are just like those people in the Old Testament. And Paul lays this out for us in Ephesians chapter 2. Here's what he says. about us, right? This is the church in the New Testament time. He says, and you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked. And it wasn't just the Israelites who sinned and rebelled against God. We've all done that. You were following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. If you look around you today and you see those people who seem to sin so much, we're those people among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind. We were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. Just like those Israelites at the base of Mount Sinai who worshiped the golden calf, we were sinful and deserving of wrath. And then verse 4, but God, our great God, who is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, when our sin deserved death and wrath, even when we were dead in our trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace we have been saved. And God raised us up with him, and he seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, four good works which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. We're just like Moses and the Israelites, sinful people who really deserve God's wrath, but to whom God has shown mercy. We are God's workmanship. And just like Moses, our job in this life is to point to him who is worthy of all glory and honor and praise. John chapter 3, verse 14 and 15 says this. Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. Our hope is in Jesus. Now today I want to give you just three quick practical applications as someone who is a part of the Church of Jesus Christ today. As you think about what God has called us to do, to make disciples, to be his witnesses, number one, remember who is in control. It's often true that when God calls us to do anything, to be his disciples or to make a disciple or to share the gospel, we do what Moses did. And we're like, God, I don't know if you know, but I get a little tongue-tied at times. You know, I'm not great with words. Maybe you should send someone else. But just be reminded that it is God who is in control. It is God who empowers us for his service. It is God who has called us to be the church and to make disciples in this place, in your home and in your workplace and in your school and in your neighborhood. It is God who works in you. Like Moses didn't cause the plagues, y'all. He couldn't lead people out of slavery in Egypt, and we can't save our neighbors, but we can make ourselves available to the God who does save, the God who does deliver. So we remember who is in control in this life, and we trust God responding in obedience to the thing that he's called us to do. We remember him who is in control. The second is we can stand in the gap for others. Every one of us in this room knows somebody whose life is being racked and destroyed by sin. Y'all, our community is overrun with drug addiction, with poverty, with abuse, addiction of, you know, 1,000 different flavors. We all know someone, and we can look back to the mercy that God showed the nation of Israel who were sinning against him, turning away from him. We can look back and be reminded that Moses stood in the gap for the people, and God, rather than giving them what they deserved, he chose to show them mercy. So what we do for people that we know who are not walking with Jesus Christ, maybe they're living in open sin, maybe they've even sinned against us, we stand in the gap for them, and we pray to God on their behalf, praying that God would draw them to repentance, that he would rescue them from the things that are ultimately destroying them. That's the heart of our God for people, and we have the opportunity to stand in the gap for others. So maybe there's someone you need to just begin to pray for fervently today. And then the final thing is we got to remember what era of history we're living in. It's a difficult day today, as you look around the world, you may be troubled by the things that you see. A question I've been hearing over and over and over is like, is this the end of times? And the truth is I don't know. I don't know how long Jesus is going to tarry, but I do know this, that we're no longer living in the day of foreshadowing. We're living in the day of fulfillment. And that what we should do is to make the most of the time that we have left here. We're not living in the foreshadowing. We're living in the fulfillment. Kings and prophets long to see what we have been able to see. They long for the day when Jesus Christ would come and offer himself as the once for all sacrifice for the sins of the world, that we would no longer be slaves to sin, but we would be free to live lives in the abundance of Jesus Christ through the power of his Holy Spirit. All of these characters of the Old Testament long to see the day that we get to live in. We're not living in the foreshadowing. We're living in the fulfillment. We are sons and daughters of God, and we have the opportunity to live like it in the riches of his kingdom. This abundant life began at the cross when Jesus paid the price for our sin, and it carries through all the way into eternity. Stop waiting for whatever thing you're waiting on to come through. Stop waiting for your circumstances to change. You have the opportunity to live today the victorious Christian life, full of love and joy and peace and all of the fruit of the Spirit. We are his church. And I don't know how long God's going to tarry, but we need to make the most of the time, remembering what era of history we live in. This is the fulfillment. Would you bow with me? Father, we do thank you once again for your word, and God, for the fact that you have redeemed us, sinful men and women. God, we sinned in every way, just as grievously as the people of the Old Testament did. And yet you are our great God who has shown us grace and mercy that was profoundly undeserved, and we praise you for that. God, may we be your church in our community. May we trust not in our own strength or gifts or abilities, but in your power as we seek to make disciples in this community. God, use us for your purposes in this place. Lord, all glory and honor, praise belongs to you. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.